Good morning and God bless you. We're delighted that you have joined us this morning. And perhaps you're visiting with us. We want to extend to you a big welcome and trust that you like what you hear. We want to start with prayer this morning. We want to remember to pray for our president and those that are in leadership of our nation. We want to pray for our community that God would open up great doors of utterance. And we want to pray for Cornerstone Pentecostal Church and our brothers and sisters all across the world. Perhaps you have a special request right now. This is a perfect time to make that known unto God. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for the baptism of the Holy Ghost and a revelation of truth. God, we pray for our president that you will continue to navigate his steps in these troubling times and keep your hand upon all those that are in leadership of our nation. God, we also pray for our community that you will open up doors of opportunity and utterance that we can share this great truth in the midst of a hopeless world. And Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters all around the world and my brothers and sisters here at Cornerstone that you will open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing and protection upon them. We ask it in the name above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. I want to draw your attention to 1 Timothy chapter number 2 this morning. We're going to start reading verse number 1. The apostle says, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. That's all men. And when we're talking about the Apostle Paul, that's talking about maybe Alexander the coppersmith. That's talking about Hymenaeus and Philetus. That's talking about people that he considered to be unreasonable. This is a giving of thanks and an intercession for all men. Verse number 2, for kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. That's what I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about leading a quiet and peaceable life in the 21st century. Praise God. You know, there's a lot of scriptures that have been used here over the course of the last 2.5 months that are reminders to us that though we are citizens of heaven on our Father's side, that we still have residency right here on planet Earth. And we have all experienced, as they have in 180 nations around the world, an economic hardship. There has been a lockdown that has been imposed upon us as a nation. In some places, it's starting to loosen up and people are beginning to regain normalcy. However, let us first keep in mind that when this lockdown first started, it was for our protection. I really do believe that. And I believe adhering to the words of our president was a wise thing to do. However, it's as of late, the news has come out that none of the models that were first used to employ some of the panic and some of the fear that has driven this culture have come to pass and lived up to. These models spoke of the potentiality of possibly several million people dying from the coronavirus. And thanks be to God, this just has not happened. But in some places, the government continues to enforce what people call and consider to be ungodly and oppressive requests upon people. I hope that maybe I can just, for a few moments, just bring a little clarity to this. Although the Bible does tell us that we should defer to those that are in authority, in fact, most notably, Romans chapter 13, because all power or all authority is from God. The Bible qualifies it in the book of Romans because, well, let's read a couple verses. Let every soul be subject to the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. This is to keep the human race from falling into anarchy and chaos. There has to be structure. And so it is the will of God that there is governmental structure. And it calls rulers, in verse number 3, for rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. But what happens if that was reversed? What happens if a ruler was against good works and promoted evil. I'm not saying any are, but I'm just trying to qualify some things here. What if that ruler was absolutely reversing those roles that are articulated in verse number 3? Look at verse number 4. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of God. In two places in verse number 4, it calls the governmental officials ministers of God. And I believe, in the way that this was written, that it is absolutely qualifying the fact that there are laws that are in place that are meant to provide us with a culture and a society in which evil can be punished and good can be promoted. But what happens if those two were ever reversed? What happens if, in our request in 1 Timothy chapter number 2, if we were actually under a despot like Nero that was not allowing us to live a godly and peaceable life? I'm just saying this to bring some clarification. I believe as long as we are under any form of government, as long as we are allowed to live a godly and peaceable life, and we are allowed to enjoy the fact that we are apostolic and we gather to worship and we're living for God in servitude and obedience to the Word of God, I believe we can put up with a whole lot. There's a whole lot in our world that we can put up with. But once those same forces try to prevent us from doing that which the Bible calls good, our worship, our devotions, our assembly, our getting together, I believe that things need to be looked at again. In Romans chapter 13, where it says that all power is of God, and it calls rulers a minister of God in verse number 4, could we really qualify Nero, who brought great persecution against the church, burning Christians alive and throwing them to the lions for sport and entertainment? Could we really classify that as being a minister of God? I think not. I think there are greater principles that need to be employed so that we can balance some of these things out and gain a common sense, spiritually provoked understanding. Thank God that we still live in a nation which allows us to worship God and worship God freely. And I thank God for that. God bless you. Thank you for joining us today. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow.